AI, right?
Mm.
Of late, many netizens, people in the internet, friends, Facebook friends, have expressed concern over your loss of job. But we are also equally puzzled as to why the hospital and especially the MOH, the ministry, would allege that you have defamed someone. And because of this, we are trying to see how we can help you, okay? In a sense, then it all started because you were talking about an important subject, the issue of CPF in all the years, in the few hundred articles that you have written in the blog. Now, can you take this opportunity to enlighten us or clarify again what exactly motivated you to talk about this CPF?
Okay. Actually, I've been writing on my blog for about 2 years now.
Mm-hmm.
When I first started it, the background was that I got to a stage in life where I was quite happy with myself. I was quite contented.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to, I looked around and I felt that people were stressful with their lives. They were pushing the doorbell buttons quite hard and they were driving and honking on the cars quite loudly. So to me, I didn't understand why people felt so stressful about their lives.
Mm-hmm.
I understand why people felt so stressful, but I can't understand why it has to be like that.
Okay.
Because Singapore is a first world country, it's a developed country, and if that's the case, I think most societies, as the economy grows, the social life grows as well.
Mm-hmm.
But why for Singapore it didn't happen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I wanted to understand why that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
So the first article I wrote was actually based on a speech that Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong gave at the Economic Society, where he compared Singapore to the Nordic countries.
Mm-hmm.
So I also, he only compared some bits, and I felt that it was a bit incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to look for more information that allows me to have a broader picture.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I saw that maybe Singapore wasn't doing as well as the Nordic countries in terms of healthcare, education, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And then that started me thinking, I think Singaporeans need more open information and we need to see the complete picture.
I think I read your one that you mentioned about Norway, no? Yeah. And so you think that if by drawing the making a comparison, perhaps it would be easier if we were going to make a study. And so can we improve the local system, the Singapore system?
Correct. Singapore is a best practice case for some countries, and I think other countries also serve as a best practice case for Singapore. So that was why I compared. If you look at, say, for tax, for example, if you look at how much Singaporeans are paying in tax and CPF, and out-of-pocket expenditure for healthcare, education, retirement, we are actually, on a per capita basis, we're actually spending about the same as the Nordic countries.
Mm-hmm.
So they only need to pay for tax, social security,
mm-hmm.
which is their CPF,
mm-hmm.
and they do not need to pay for out-of-pocket expenditure in a sense, because healthcare, education, retirement is covered by tax.
Uh-huh.
So if we are actually paying similar to them,
mm-hmm.
why is it that they are much more taken care of when it comes to health, education?
Have you identified the problems, that the differences, why you were shocked we have a shortfall in that area?
Yeah, I think the reason is first, our wages are low.
Mm-hmm.
For the Nordic countries, say in Norway, the minimum the cleaner mm-hmm. would earn about $5,000. But in Singapore, a cleaner earns $800.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the other thing is, even though Singaporeans pay low tax,
mm-hmm.
but then we pay the highest CPF contribution rate among the world.
Mm-hmm.
The 37% that we pay is actually comparable to the tax and social security that low income earners pays in the Nordic countries. So in that sense, we are actually paying as much. But because the government returns in Singapore, what the government gives back in terms of social protection
mm.
is the lowest among the developed countries.
Yeah.
That means that whatever we pay in tax does not come back to us. Yeah.
In terms of the returns.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, I think, yeah, in a way I also observe that Singapore actually has many avenues to generate revenues, like through gaming. Many forms of gambling, and even we have levies, but I don't know, with the Nordic, I don't think they have such, maybe.
I think their system is a lot more transparent and a lot clearer. Because even though our personal income tax is low, but then the indirect tax that we pay is several times higher than the personal income tax.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in the Nordic countries, the personal income tax is high, but
mm-hmm.
whatever they pay in indirect tax is almost the same, and it's
mm-hmm.
not so much higher. So in Singapore's situation, it is that we pay so much in indirect tax that we do not actually know, because we pay it through GST, we pay it through COE. Yeah. So when it all adds up, it's actually quite a lot of money that can actually come back in terms of
social security. Yeah, comparing also countries that have got a small population.
Correct, because the Nordic countries have about 5 million.
9 million, yeah.
9 million, yeah.
The thing is, well, the other thing is also, do you take factor into consideration how much those countries spend on the government salaries as compared to Singapore?
That's a very good question. When we went to Norway, we spoke to a labor union. So the labor union told us that for a high income earner, which is actually the prime minister, she currently earns only $300,000 every year. So you know, we laughed. $300,000. Do you know our prime minister earns $2.2 million?
I think that's equivalent to maybe a perm site. I don't know whether.
The thing is that the wage gap is very low, because a cleaner earns $5,000 every month, and then the prime minister
is $5,000.
It's about 25,000 every month. Yeah, so it's actually very narrow. But in Singapore, it's a cleaner earns $800, and then the prime minister earns somewhere $83,000 every month. So the gap is
not including bonuses and all the directorships. Yeah, this could be thing. How are we going to remedy the situation like this?
I don't think Singaporeans are actually upset that the Prime Minister or the government, I don't think that the Singaporeans are actually upset that the government chooses to pay themselves high salaries, because if you can deliver the results, Singaporeans are more than happy to do so. But the problem now is that the government might have failed in some aspects, in transport and healthcare. If we're just looking at wages, the wages of a low-wage worker hasn't been increasing for 20 years.
Yeah, but not only that, I have been staying overseas for the last 7 years, and as a short return trip, I realized that I have not seen so many problems overseas, where old folks are in the black, so I have black problems, unemployment, and falling sick, and then not able to see doctors or pay for medical costs and fees. So this worried me, because I think why it's not happening in the countries that I've stayed. Even when I was in China for the 6 years, I rarely see old folks having to struggle in their late 60s, 70s. They all enjoy their retirement, and their grandchildren, and they go exercising in the evenings, sing song, dance. So this is not happening here. And I see cleaners and the people, especially the lower strata or the underclass here. And why are we not doing anything? Yeah, this worries me. Could it be that they cannot withdraw the CPF? Could it be that they have not enough earnings? And that draws to one other problem, is the HDB. Now, in real life, that most Singaporeans would have to have a roof. And a big part of their life is spent earning money to pay for this expensive HDB flat, which is a necessity. I think some 81% of the people, Singaporeans, are actually staying in HDB flat. So if you think about this, if you're earning so much and you have to pay so much for a flat, how much more can you save for your old age or retirement? So I'm thinking about this. What do you say?
Actually, when I went to South Korea, on weekends, what happened is that the elderly, they would, instead of walking, they would actually go climb mountains. They would,
good life.
go with each other. So a whole group of elderly would go together. And to me, I don't think it makes sense that Singaporeans, when you want to stay active, when you're old, you actually have to go clean. Be a cleaner or be a cardboard collector. So, the government's idea is that for elderly to stay active, you should work. But then I think for the elderly ones, since they have worked so hard for Singapore, then they should actually have the free will to say, if I want to keep active, I want to take up a hobby.
Yeah. I think in the West, the idea of retirement, in fact, I think maybe decades ago, 100 years ago, people have already set a certain age that they think is the best age for you to retire and so-called enjoy a bit of life, because your body cannot, your body system cannot take on hard work, and that you need mental rest as well. So I think it justifies that you should have a meaningful retirement for anybody. I think here, the sad thing is some people in their middle age, at 40 or so, they have pretty been retrenched and they've lost their job. And they have not been able to get back that kind of salary they used to enjoy. And they still have children undergoing school, education, and having other commitments. So even if the children have grown up, they also may not earn enough to help them, their parents. So given this situation, we are trapped. We're trapped in a situation. Like, I think I admire that you have the courage to bring about this problem, because this is the current problem Singaporeans face. The inability to support their parents, the inability to support themselves or even their children. And if we don't address this problem, it will get worse. So the CPF, back to the CPF, from your study into the CPF, how would you think that we can improve?
Actually, for the CPF, I think it has been very complicated. So now we have the ordinary account, we have the special MediSave account, we have the retirement account, we have the CPF minimum sum, MediSave, MediShield. But all these are constructs that that confuses the system. Because if we really look at the basics, this is your retirement fund, how do you grow it? The best way to grow it is to increase wages and then increase the interest rates on the CPF. I think it should be as clear as that. Because once our wages increase, once the CPF interest rates increase, the CPF will grow by itself, and when you want to take out the money to use, you will have enough to use on a monthly basis. So the CPF minimum sum is actually an artificial limit cap there. That instead of growing the CPF itself to allow Singaporeans to have enough, the government puts the CPF minimum sum and wait for Singaporeans to grow it, knowing that Singaporeans will never reach that. Because the thing is, the CPF minimum sum from the mid-1990s have grown by 7% or more, but the wages and CPF itself has only grown by about 2 to 2.5%.
Ideally, it should be in tandem with the goal to grow.
Or at least faster than inflation, or with inflation in some extent. So, what I'm also uncomfortable about is, so if we just look at wages, so wages and interest rates should grow. For wages, for the past 20 years, for low income, it has stayed at 800. 20 years ago, today it has stayed at 800. And then also the other thing is for low income earners, from 40 to 45 years old, their income will actually start to drop. So what it means is that for low income and lower middle income Singaporeans, if they cannot save enough to retire, it is because they were not paid adequate wages for the past 10-20 years before they could retire. So one reason why CPF isn't growing is because wages were growing and there is no protection to protect the wages. The other thing is interest rates have remained at 2.5 to 4%. But why is it arbitrary push down to 2.5% when in the 1970s and 1980s it was as high as 6.5%? I mean, the government has created, told us of the idea that the CPF is invested in bonds, which gives us a secure interest. But the government has, in the past, has chosen not to tell us what happens after that. So some people have speculated that the CPF is invested in the JX and Temasek Holdings. So I did trace to several websites that did indicate that the CPF is invested in bonds, is put into the reserves, and then invested by JIC and Temasek Holdings. So if that's the case, and they are earning 6.5 to 16%, then that interest should be channeled back. Because based on the Asian Development Bank Institute, this interest that is not channeled back is actually an implicit tax that the government is making us pay to the government.
It's not fair. Maybe it's like borrowing money from us, and then they use that money to invest. If they make profits, it goes to them.
And there's no transparency at all. In fact, it was only because a few of us, actually a lot of Singaporeans, started saying that, okay, look, now we know that the CPF is invested in the JX and Temasek Holdings. Can you please tell us what the truth is? And it is only recently, I think last year, that the government started telling us, yes, GIC manages your CPF. And then on the GIC's website, they say, we manage your CPF, but as to how it is managed, it is not made explicit to us. And then the other thing they say is that the government doesn't interfere in the GIC. And then if you look at the board of directors, it is the Prime Minister, the Deputy Prime Minister.
The board of directors are also playing watchdog.
So there's a conflict of interest.
So I get back to the ordinary citizens' concern. I think the fact that because the CPF takes a lot of this minimum sum the contribution and or MediSave contribution, that leaves very little disposable income. And because of this, the economy is also affected. I mean, if you don't money to spend, how will you create a better economy? the spending, I can see that many shops are closing down these days, and then the high renters, the renters are going to where? These properties are usually owned by big boys, you know, in Singapore, either if it's the CapitaLand, if not it's a big few, and then together with banks. So unless the renter is cut down, bring down to a realistic level, shop owners cannot make things cheap.
Yeah.
Consumers cannot buy things cheap.
Companies cannot
So this is a problem. And I think if how collectively can the different entities come together and say, hey, we have to do something about this. Stop people from profiteering too much. Stop people from manipulating their renters too high. And then also the influx of the foreigners coming into Singapore. Big wide open floodgate, people come in and bidding. 800 you don't take, somebody's going to do it for 600 because you must know, I have studied on these foreign people. I'm talking about foreign workers, not white color, foreign workers. They're here very desperate because some of them sell the land, they borrow money here to get by, to get hopefully in the hope of making some money. And then when they're stranded here, they do anything because they're still in debt. They have to pay to the debtors. So this is the scenario we are facing. Okay, back to the CPF. If they have given us more percentage and be more transparent, do you see this as a good solution?
Yeah, I think for the CPF itself, the question is, if the CPF is managed by itself with its own investment funds and own fund managers who are investing in, and there's clear transparency and accountability just for the CPF, and there are no external linkages, then that's fine. But the problem now is it has been confused, complicated, because it is invested into bonds, reserves, GIC.
Then you trace back then how
Because if the CPF operates by itself and we know what funds is invested in, we know what the returns are with clarity, and Singaporeans can then say, okay, I don't think the funds are good enough, I want to go into another fund, or I want to know that we should actually be able to invest in a certain way. We have transparency and we have a say as to how we want it to be invested. Then at least Singaporeans can have a say.
Okay. So Roy, are you advocating that there should be some liberty freedom of choice then for the CPF holder to exercise it himself, that he what he intends to invest leaves it to him, kind of thing?
Well, in a way, yes, because if you look at Hong Kong's model, Hong Kong actually gives you a whole list of investment funds that you can earn and the interest rates that you will earn and the administrative charges that you will pay, which is up to about 2% or so. And the Hong Kong Retirement Funds has someone who is there to help you to so pretty much like an insurance agent who will help you to look at which funds you want to invest, let you know what the returns are, put it together for you. And then there's also a ability for you to say that if the funds make losses, there's an insurance to protect yourself from losses.
That's good.
Yeah. So I think the responsibility of the government should be to say, okay, I'm going to be transparent to you, these are what the funds you have. And then the second thing is the government should say that we'll have to look long term, because all investments you have to look long term. And the government has to be honest to say no interest is actually ever secure. So to say that it's secure is actually a fallacy. But what happens is the government publishes, in Hong Kong, publishes a report on a 10-year basis. So from 2001 to 2010, there were years, there was 1 year where the earnings actually went up to above 30%. So that was quite high. And then in another year, it dropped. It made a 25% loss. But on the average, there was a 5.5% increase in the retirement funds, which means that on the overall, it is still much higher than what Singaporeans are earning. The 2.5%.
I think it's only fair if things go transparent, because there's no way you make it unknown, make it hidden. Right. And the other thing is also, this being the case, so how we see this, the future take on this? Your case, how would you go about fighting? Would you advocate?
I mean, right now I am able to talk about the CPF mainly.
But you still go on with this, like that you still insist that the government would need to be open about their investments, divestments?
I think all along we have always been talking about transparency and accountability. So the thing is, like I say, the CPF as a whole has been made too complicated with too many things. The CPF, minimum sum, MediSave, ordinary account, special
account. Many of these, I think the ordinary people cannot meet. If they are not earning 5,000 and above, actually you cannot meet all whatever some that they're talking about.
Right.
It also, I think it stifles the entrepreneurship. Actually, some old folks, they say in their mid-60s, if they take the whole lump sum, they could maybe join with friends or their spouses and then say, hey, let's do a bakery. And then and that's something their passion, they want to do, a flower shop.
Yeah.
And if you say, hey, no, we do buy energies for you and make sure that you can only collect $800 a month. And then it means that your life is so regimented that you can't do anything.
Yeah.
Yeah. Your whole life is just working, buying an expensive HDB flat, and then going by that plan that you set, that you go, you collect this enough, hand to mouth if you're lucky. If not, then you'll be living half in debt.
Yeah.
And it's meaningless.
Actually, like you say, I think there needs to be flexibility. Mm-hmm. I mean, so first and foremost, wages should increase, interest rates mm-hmm. should increase, so that the CPF by itself should increase. And then when it's time for people to take it out, mm-hmm. they should have the flexibility to say, should I want to take it out a lump sum or half of it?
Yeah.
Or if I keep my CPF inside, I know that because the interest rates are high.
I think it should be fair. I think some people want to opt for the energy, something. I think it's also up to them.
Yeah. But if interest rates are high, at least I know that I feel safe keeping my money inside.
I think it has to be in terms of market offer. I mean, what's in the market?
Yeah.
I mean, it's variable, but sometimes it goes higher, and then the CPF should adjust to that.
Yeah, maybe the other thing is now I think a lot of Singaporeans feel that I want to take my money out.
Mm.
The reason why is because they don't trust the CPF anymore. Yeah,
and that's very dangerous because when people lose confidence in the government, then I think that the ball is not in the government's court, that they have to reassure Singaporeans by opening their books and say, hey, look, everything is here.
Correct.
And then tell us where we're heading.
Correct. And also to give Singaporeans the choice to say, this is now what it is. Now, how would you like it to be done? I will listen to you. I'll make sure I'll do the research and do a long-term planning.
Yeah, I think that's correct. That should be the way. Very fair. But I think people appreciate your efforts in doing this, and I hope more people join you in hoping that or in pushing the government, to pressurizing the government to say, come forward and come up with better plans.
Yeah.
And help the people, because some of the people, they are not daring enough to say, put forward like you yourself. So in here, I would, on behalf of Singapore, thank you for all your efforts.
Thank you.
Thank you for this.
Thank you.
Bye.